Hello, everyone. Bon vendredi, tout le monde. I'd like to begin by addressing what unfolded in Washington, D.C. this week. What we witnessed was an assault on democracy by violent rioters incited by the current president and other politicians. As shocking, deeply disturbing, and frankly saddening as that event remains, we've also seen this week that democracy is resilient in America, our closest ally and neighbor. Violence has no place in our societies, and extremists will not succeed in overruling the will of the people. As Canadians, I think we've been all reflecting on our own country, something I spoke with the premiers about last night, about the fact that democracy is not automatic. It takes work every day. About what a real accomplishment it is to maintain a political system in which the losing side gracefully concedes and in which rival political parties between elections work together for the common good. We have this in Canada because Canadians make it possible. Canadians expect their political leaders to protect our precious democracy by how we conduct ourselves. We have seen this manifest in unanimous consent in our Parliament for our main COVID-fighting measures at a time when the government holds a minority of seats. We see it in the cooperation between the federal government and provincial and territorial governments, regardless of political stripe. Canadians expect debate. Debate in service of all Canadians. Debate that is grounded in a shared acceptance of the facts. In a diverse country, there will always be diverse perspectives, and it is through respect for those differences that we create a stronger Canada. Canadian democracy didn't happen by accident, and it won't continue without work. We must always work to secure our democracy and not give comfort to those who promote things that are not true or give space for hatred or extremism. Hier, lors de notre 24e réunion des premiers ministres des provinces et territoires, on a commencé par parler de ce qui s'est passé aux États-Unis cette semaine. On a tous été choqués de voir des extrémistes incités par le président agir avec autant de violence pour saccager le Capitole à Washington. Ça nous rappelle à quel point on ne peut pas prendre notre démocratie pour acquis. La démocratie au Canada, c'est pas un hasard. Et ça ne va pas continuer sans effort. Les Canadiens s'attendent à des débats honnêtes qui servent leurs intérêts, des débats qui partagent le même ensemble de faits. Nous devons tous travailler ensemble pour protéger la démocratie contre ceux qui font la promotion de mensonges et qui créent de l'espace pour la haine et l'extrémisme. Avec les premiers ministres, on a aussi abordé la question des centres de soins de longue durée, des mesures pour les voyageurs, du dépistage et des vaccins. Notre gouvernement travaille sur les vaccins sans relâche depuis des mois. Le processus de distribution est réglé au quart de tour. La distribution des doses, surtout pour le vaccin de Pfizer, représente des défis complexes. Mais grâce aux efforts de tous, on a pu commencer à distribuer des doses plus tôt que prévu, à partir du 21 décembre. On fait tout ce qu'on peut pour obtenir le plus de vaccins possible, le plus rapidement possible. Le major général Fortin va présenter les chiffres en détail aujourd'hui. En décembre, nous avions distribué près d'un demi-million de doses à travers le pays, incluant un peu plus de 88 000 doses au Québec. D'ici la fin janvier, ce sera environ 1,3 millions de doses du vaccin de Pfizer et de Moderna qui seront livrées aux provinces et aux territoires. On veut tous que la pandémie se termine au plus vite. Des gens qui meurent, des hôpitaux débordés, des emplois menacés, ça fait plaisir à personne de voir ça. On est en temps de crise et les Canadiens veulent des résultats. Je les comprends et je leur promets qu'on travaille sans relâche. On continue de collaborer tous les ordres de gouvernement ensemble, comme une grande équipe. Plus que jamais, c'est le temps de rassembler nos forces pour battre la COVID-19 une bonne fois pour toutes. Yesterday, at our 24th First Minister's meeting, the Premiers and I discussed the vaccine rollout across the country. We agreed that it is vital that we work together as Team Canada to get vaccines delivered, distributed and administered as quickly and efficiently as possible. The Premiers and I also discussed ways to combat misinformation. Vaccines are safe and effective, and everyone should be doing their part by getting vaccinated once it's their turn. This week, over 124,000 doses of the Pfizer vaccine were delivered to 68 sites across the country. Over 208 Pfizer doses will be delivered weekly for the rest of January. On Moderna, by the end of next week, over 171,000 doses will be delivered to the provinces and territories. We're on track to deliver approximately 1.3 million doses of the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines by the end of January. Quantities of both the Pfizer and the Moderna vaccine will scale up in February. Remember that Canada has the most vaccines secured per capita in the world, which means that by September, we will have enough vaccines for every Canadian who wants one. Our top priority remains keeping you and your family safe. I know things are tough right now. Frankly, it's frightening to see cases rise at home and around the world day after day. But you're not in this alone. We continue to be there for you. We're continuing to send millions of pieces of PPE to protect healthcare workers and communities. We will do whatever it takes for as long as it takes. For you, for family, for your communities, we will have your backs. And on that note, I can also confirm that yesterday, the Canadian Armed Forces approved a request for support to the Fort Albany First Nation in Ontario as they deal with a COVID-19 outbreak. The Canadian Rangers will be activated on the ground until at least January 11th. By working together, we will get through this. Alors que plusieurs provinces annoncent des mesures plus strictes pour diminuer la propagation de la COVID-19, plusieurs personnes s'inquiètent de ce que ça signifie pour leur emploi et pour leur famille. Notre gouvernement va continuer d'être là pour vous. Ce matin, nous avons appris que l'économie canadienne a perdu 63 000 emplois en décembre, surtout des emplois liés à l'industrie du service. Depuis le début de la pandémie, notre gouvernement a agi rapidement pour soutenir notre économie et pour soutenir directement les Canadiens. Vous pouvez être certain qu'on fait tout ce qu'on peut pour vous aider à traverser ces moments difficiles. Measures like the wage subsidy are making a real difference for workers and businesses who need it. For a promising new company like StrongPoint in Toronto, the wage subsidy helped keep employees on the payroll when things got tough in the spring. It was a lifeline for them. The same goes for staff at the communication firm, the Humphrey Group. The wage subsidy helped them retain their hardworking employees and get ready for recovery. It's not good news for anyone if local businesses have to close shop for good because of this global crisis. In the second wave, this is not the time to take the foot off the gas. It's the time to keep doing everything we need to ensure that our economy stays resilient and that workers and families can weather this storm. Mercredi, le Québec a annoncé un renforcement et un prolongement des mesures de confinement. C'est important que vous sachiez que le gouvernement fédéral est là pour soutenir les provinces alors qu'elles doivent prendre des décisions difficiles. Pour les Québécois et pour tous les Canadiens, les mesures sont en place pour vous aider. La subvention salariale est là pour les travailleurs et les petites entreprises. Pour ceux qui en ont besoin, on a changé l'assurance-emploi pour soutenir un plus grand nombre de personnes. On ne vous laissera pas tomber. Comme je l'ai dit plus tôt, les vaccins continuent d'être livrés et on a des raisons de rester optimistes. Mais pour l'instant, il faut suivre les directives de la santé publique. Restez chez vous, évitez les rassemblements. Et servez-vous de l'application gratuite alerte COVID. Ceux qui décident de voyager à l'encontre des avis de la santé publique doivent faire une quarantaine obligatoire de 2 semaines en rentrant au pays. Si cette quarantaine n'est pas respectée, les conséquences légales sont très sévères. Depuis hier, il est aussi obligatoire pour les voyageurs d'avoir un résultat de test de COVID-19 négatif avant de pouvoir prendre l'avion pour leur retour. Quand on se compare avec les autres pays, nos mesures aux frontières sont parmi les plus strictes au monde. Now, more than ever, it is crucial that you keep doing your part to protect yourself, to help our healthcare workers, and to save lives. Wear your mask, avoid gatherings, and use the COVID Alert app. The app has now been updated to work on older models of iPhones, such as the iPhone 5, 6, and 6 Plus. Almost 6 million people have downloaded the app. And of course, the more Canadians use it, the more powerful this tool becomes. So keep it up, and remember, we're all in this together. This morning, I'd like to take a moment to recognize that today marks the one-year anniversary of the Ukraine International Airlines Flight 752 tragedy. As a country, we remember all those we lost, and we mourn with their families and friends. Of the victims aboard that flight, 138 of them were on their way to Canada. To the family members and friends who had planned to pick their loved ones up at the airport, to everyone who was looking forward to seeing your beloved partner, child or parent, I cannot imagine your pain. Know that you are in our thoughts today. This kind of unthinkable tragedy must never happen again. That's why, over the past year, our government developed the Safer Skies Initiative and worked with partners around the world to help keep civilian aircraft away from dangerous conflict zones. Today, on the first National Day of Remembrance for Victims of Air Disasters, we remember and honor all those we lost. The victims of PS 752, just like the victims of Ethiopian Airlines Flight 302, Air India Flight 182, and other air disasters, will never be forgotten. We will be there for each other through tough times. It's what Canadians do. Whether it's grieving for elders we lost in long-term care homes, whether it's mourning together for victims of international tragedies, or whether it's standing with courageous young people like Isabella Kulak, a member of Côté First Nation Saskatchewan, who wore her ribbon skirt to school to celebrate her culture last month. Let's remember who we are, people who are there for each other. In tough times, we pull together. We look out for each other. We support each other. It's what Canadians have learned to do through generations of dealing with winter, dealing with vast spaces, being there for each other, being there for our neighbors. We need to make it through this winter now. We need to pull together while staying apart. We need to hang in there. Spring is coming. Summer is coming. It always does. This one will be better if we can pull together right. So stay safe, everyone. And we'll talk to you again soon.